All right, so the title I'm taking out of that passage there is, I have told you already and you did not hear. And there's also other times in the Bible too where Jesus says, you know, behold, I have told you already. But I was reading through Matthew and there's a phrase that kept sticking out to me, so I want to preach on that phrase. And it's on the fulfilling of Scripture through Christ and the phrase that it might be fulfilled. That comes up, I think, about nine or ten times in the book of Matthew. So we're going to look at some instances of that today, and also some similar phrasing to see how Jesus, the Son of God, fulfilled the law, what he came to do, who he was, the nature of God, and things like that. And we're mainly going to be in Matthew because that's where that phrase is found. But it would also take months if you were to go through every instance that Jesus had actually been prophesied and fulfilled when he came. So we're just going to take a look at Matthew today. So if you want to go to Matthew chapter 1, verse 18, the first one we're looking at here is the birth of Jesus Christ. So that's the first fulfillment, the first prophecy and fulfillment in the book of Matthew about Jesus. In Matthew 1, verse 18, it says, now the birth of Christ was on this wise, when as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary, thy wife, for that which is conceived of her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. So I just want to see something here that I just picked up on as well. Another prophecy is that he'll be of the kingship of David. So we see there's already one thing fulfilled here, even though it's not, you know, being brought up that it may be fulfilled. But being a son of David, being a son of, you know, of God and of David in that kingly lineage is something that was prophesied that Jesus would be. But we see in verse 22, now all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which is spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, I behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is being interpreted, is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till he had brought forth her firstborn son, and called his name Jesus. So, of course, this is prophesied in Isaiah 7:14, where it says, therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. So the reason Jesus came, he came to fulfill Scripture. It was all prophesied that the Savior was going to come, why he was going to come, to pay for the sins of the whole world, that whosoever believeth in him shall receive eternal life. And that's all prophesied back, you know, all the way back in the beginning. So even Abraham understood that, Abel understood that, you know, everybody understood that in the Old Testament. You know, so he came down in the form of a man to live a perfect and sinless life, because we can't live that life, and to give us his imputed righteousness for all the good things he did, and also for not being a sinner. So we receive his sinless perfection. We also receive all his good works. So that's the righteousness we receive. But you see, there's also an expectation of knowledge of God's word and his prophets. You know, the angel told Joseph to call his name Jesus and said, this will fulfill Scripture. It'll fulfill that Scripture in Isaiah 7. And I have heard some foolish preaching out there that his name wasn't supposed to be Jesus, it's supposed to be Emmanuel. But it says clearly here that the angel told him to call his name Jesus and said, this is fulfilling the prophecy to call his name Emmanuel. You know, because Emmanuel means God with us, and Jesus means he will save us from our sins. You know, that's what that name means. It said, you know, because he shall save his people from their sins. That's why he was called Jesus. And you know, that's the hope we have in here, but it does in fact fulfill that Scripture. So if you hear anyone saying something else, that his name should be something else other than Jesus, then they're wrong. The angel told him, and God himself told him to call his name Jesus, and, you know, Joseph did what he was told to do. And this is something that the wise shall understand. Like Brother Jason a few weeks ago preached a sermon on the wise shall understand. There was some good stuff in that if you want to go and listen to it. But in order to understand those things, you've got to be a faith. You've actually got to be a child of God. You've got to believe first in the Word of God before you can understand these spiritual things. To read and get the wisdom and knowledge of God, you know, you need the Scriptures and you need to read them. And Christ expected that those who he was coming across in his life had read the Scriptures and knew them and understood them. You know, and you do see that expectation all through the New Testament, through the Gospels. So we're going to look at a few examples of people watching out for the Lord, people who were wise, who were saved, who did understand the Word of God, and were actually looking for the Messiah at that time. Because they knew His coming was imminent. The signs were there. He says He gave us these things for a sign. The Lord Himself shall give you a sign. That sign is that He'll be born of a virgin. They'll call His name Emmanuel. That was the sign. So some people were looking for that. And it's why He leaves us signs, you know, not just for His first coming. He left them signs, but He's leaving signs as well for His second coming, so that we're not taken by surprise. So I'll just read to you from Hebrews 1:1. It says, God, who at sundry times in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken to us by His Son, whom He hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also He made the worlds. So all the prophets in the Old Testament scriptures, they all point to Christ in some way. Some of them are actually direct, like in Jeremiah 7 and Isaiah 53, and of course many of the Psalms. Many of those are prophecies of the Lord and His coming, as well as His nature, just who God is, you know, so we can understand who He is, and then not be surprised when He does things a certain way, because He's outlined that this is who God is. So that, and it comes back to Sam, like with chastisement, like we understand God is a God, is a Father who loves us, and He chastises us because He loves us. You know, so if you're a child, you're going to be chastised. If you're a bastard, of course, you're not going to be chastised. So if you're not a child of God and you're receiving no chastisement, that's why. But God, you know, He expected that first generation to understand who He was. If you want to turn to John chapter 1, verse 43. And we'll just look at Philip here. He's somebody who knew that Christ was coming and was ready for it. In John chapter 1, verse 43, it says, the day following, Jesus would go forth into Galilee, and findeth Philip, and saith unto him, follow me. Now Philip was of Bethsaida, a city of Andrew and Peter. Philip finding Nathanael, and saith unto him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Now, how did he know that? How did he know? This is the man that Moses wrote off. He's like, look, we found the man that Moses wrote off. We found him. Nathanael said unto him, can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? Philip saith unto him, come and see. Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him, and saith of him, behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile. So he was saved. You know, he already believed on the Lord. So he, but then he also had read the Bible. He read the scriptures. He read Moses, and he knew to wait for the Christ. And when he saw the Christ, he said, hey, that's him. That's the guy. You know, and Christ expects that of us too. Nathanael answered and said unto him, Rabbi, thou art the Son of God, thou art the King of Israel. Jesus answered and said unto him, behold, I saith unto thee, I saw thee under the fig tree. Believest thou? Thou shalt see greater things than these. And he saith unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, hereafter ye shall see heaven open, and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. So Philip knew who Christ was. He knew that He was the Son of God. He knew that He was the Lord God of the Old Testament. And he knew that He was the Messiah, the Savior of all men, but especially of those that believe. But how did he know? He knew that through the writings of Moses and the prophets. And, I mean, that's how we can know. I'll just turn to Romans chapter 10, if you want to turn along with me. Romans chapter 10, verse 16. But we see all through Scripture, there's an expectation that being, you know, believing on Christ and getting saved is one thing. But also reading the Bible and knowing what He says and actually believing and trusting in His promises is the next step. That's what God commands of us. So Romans 10 verse 16 says, but they have not all obeyed the gospel, for Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. But I say, have they not heard? Yes, verily, their sound went into all the earth, and their words into the ends of the world. But I say, did not Israel know? For Moses saith, I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation I will anger you. But Isaiah is very bold and saith, I was found of them that sought me not. I was made manifest unto them that asked not after me. But to Israel he saith, all day long have I stretched forth my hands unto a disobedient and gainsaying people. These are people who had the word of God, they had the prophets of God, and they didn't listen. Not only did they not enter into the rest, they didn't get saved, but also they, you know, like obviously because of that, they couldn't keep the commandments. They couldn't do anything. They just, you know, basically excluded from that covenant because they first didn't believe on the Lord. They didn't believe the report of all the witnesses. And there is a great cloud of witnesses that tells us who Christ is, you know, who the Lord of the Old Testament and the New Testament is. It's the same Lord. Turn to John chapter 3. John chapter 3, verse 1, and you'll see Nicodemus. You know, we all know Nicodemus, and you know, we're all in this church very familiar with John chapter 3. But we'll just read John 3, verse 1. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. So he should know what he's talking about. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest, except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus saith unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say unto thee, You must be born again. The wind bloweth whither it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh, and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus answered and said unto them, How can these things be? Jesus answered and said unto him, Art thou a master of Israel, and knowest not these things? Verily I say unto thee, We speak that we do know, and testify that we have seen, and ye receive not our witness. And don't let that be said of you. You know, when you're reading through the Bible, receive the witness of God, receive the witness of the prophets. You know, understand that, you know, what they're teaching about the promises of God. Hey, they're all for you. They're for me. They're for all of us, the children of God. All those promises that were given to Abraham, all those promises of the old covenant, you know, under the new covenant as well. All those promises are for us. We can go boldly into the throne of grace and enter in and speak to the Father. You know, that's a promise that's given to us. But imagine if you didn't believe that. You'd never pray to the Father. You don't receive the witness of these promises that are given to us by the apostles and the prophets. For them, it was a salvation issue. They all went to hell because they didn't believe the witnesses. At least I thank God that everyone here, you know, I believe has received that witness, at least. In John 5:45. So the Lord expected him to understand what he was saying. You know, the law spoke of Christ and that circumcision of the heart made without hands. That's, you know, you see that as early as Deuteronomy. You know, that's all mentioned, and possibly even earlier. But that's being born again. And these are spiritual things made to be understood by God's children. He wants us to understand his word. He wants us to read it and understand it. And after this, he goes on to give the clearest, you know, explanation of the gospel. John 3:16, everyone knows John 3:16. But, you know, even before then, it's like Moses, he's talking about how Moses was lifted up. When he lifted up that serpent in the wilderness, that's a picture of Christ being lifted up on the cross. You know, so we look to Christ. That's why we have that look and live. That hymn, you know, it's a great hymn, because we look and live, and we look to the Lord Christ, who's the Savior, and then we're saved, you know, by believing on him. So in John 5, verse 45, as you turn there, it says, Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom you trust. For had you believed Moses, you would have believed me, for he wrote of me. But if you believe not his writings, how shall you believe my words? See, the reason they didn't believe Christ is because they didn't believe Moses. They didn't believe Isaiah. They didn't believe Jeremiah. They didn't believe any of the prophets. You know, and Christ expected those scribes and Pharisees to believe Moses and the words that wrote of him. But, you know, it seemed like it was a secret to them that they didn't understand that the God of the Old Testament, the Lord, is the same Lord of the New Testament. He's the same God. There is one God. There's one Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. You know, the Lord Jehovah in the Old Testament is God, Jesus Christ, in the New Testament. That's something we understand, but they didn't. But Moses understood that. He understood that there's one Lord and one God. He even wrote of one Lord and one God. But they don't understand that. They believe that their God is one, that it's just the Father. But there's actually, they don't understand, they don't believe in the Son, which is why they don't have the Father. Can't have the Son with Father without the Son. But there are a lot of people who understood. Like, there was that expectation. Philip knew that he was the Son of God, and he said as much. Peter had it revealed to him by the Father when he was speaking with Jesus. He said, look, my Father's revealed it to you. But he says, look, you're the Christ. Peter understood that. There were the wise men at his birth who came looking to give him gifts. So they understood the timing and also who he was. They came to bless the Lord God on earth. But that's the thing, if you don't read and believe the Bible, if you don't read and believe the words of Moses, you're not going to know these things. And that was the issue with the scribes and the Pharisees. They just didn't believe. They would not receive that witness, you know, of those who prophesied of Christ and of the promises and the things to come. See, they want all the promises of the land and all the blessings and everything else, but they don't want Christ. Well, you can't have that without Christ. They rejected Christ. That's why God rejected them as a nation. So we understand the expectation of the Lord that he expects us to know these things, that the words he's given us in his book, in his, you know, in the King James Bible in English, he wants us to know these things and also to understand the fulfillment of past scripture and also the coming fulfillment of scripture. So I will look at the next mention in Matthew chapter 2, verse 13, of Jesus fulfilling scripture. So in Matthew 2:13, it says, and when they were departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise and take the young child and his mother, and flee into Egypt, and be there until I bring thee word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed into Egypt, and was there until the death of Herod, that he might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, out of Egypt have I called my son. So the scripture for this is in Hosea 11, verse 1. I'll just read it to you. It says, when Israel was a child, then I loved him and called my son out of Egypt. So that end statement is about Christ, of course, the future fulfillment at that time. It's past to us. But it's also the chapters about Israel's past, about how he actually brought them, his children, out of Egypt, out of the captivity. But you can see also that the exodus from Egypt of Israel is another sign pointing to Christ coming out of Egypt. So again, something else that was fulfilled that if you're not paying attention, you'll miss it. Matthew 2:23, just go down a few verses, says, and he came and dwelt in a city called Nazareth, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophets, he shall be called a Nazarene. So from what I understand, there isn't a record of this in Scripture as far as written, but this is the record, that it says it was spoken by the prophets, therefore it was spoken by the prophets. There's no way around that. So we know it was spoken by the prophets, but it was not, as far as I know, mentioned, you know, in any of the books as being written down. But you do remember in John chapter 1:45, where we read about Philip and Nathanael, it says, we have found of him of whom Moses and the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And Nathanael said unto him, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Philip saith unto him, come and see. So a Nazarene here just means he was from Nazareth. So Jesus from Nazareth was fulfilling that prophecy, even though it's not recorded as far as written. We know it was at least spoken. But that's also not to be confused with a Nazarite. So you had Samson, you know, took the Nazarite vow from birth. But there are others also who could take a Nazarite vow, but that was just a period of holiness. You'd just do that for a short time where you'd abstain from certain things that God commanded. A Nazarite, this is not saying that Jesus was a Nazarite. He was a Nazarene. He was from Nazareth. So then him being from Nazareth fulfills that scripture. And we see its fulfillment all through. If you want to turn to Matthew chapter 4, verse 12. Matthew chapter 4, verse 12. It says, now when Jesus had heard that John was cast into prison, he departed into Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is upon the seacoast, in the borders of Zebulun and Naphtali, that he might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, the land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people which sat in darkness saw great light, and to them which sat in the region and shadow of death, light is sprung up. From that time Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So we see here a prophecy that light's going to come to this dark land. And And we see that that's the light of the gospel. This is when Jesus begins his ministry. This is the first time he's preaching the kingdom is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. That's the time he begins his ministry. So, and the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven, that's the same thing. It's always interchangeable in scripture. There's not one for the Jews and one for us. You know, there's one kingdom, and it's the kingdom of all believers, whether they be Jew, Greek, Gentile, barbarian, Scythian, whatever. There's one kingdom. And it's all who are of faith. So, but of course, that's referring back to Isaiah chapter 9. If you want to turn there as well, you're welcome to. I'll just read from Isaiah chapter 9, verse 1. Isaiah 9, 1 says, "Nevertheless, the dimness shall not be as such as was in her vexation, when at the first he lightly afflicted the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterward did much grievously afflict her, by the way of the sea beyond Jordan in Galilee of the nations. The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them hath the light shined. Thou hast multiplied the nation and not increased the joy before thee according to the joy in harvest, and as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For thou hast broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. For every battle of the warrior is with confused noise and garments rolled in blood, but this shall be with burning and fuel of fire. For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." I mean, there's just so many prophecies here of Christ in just this passage. But just those promises, like he has broken the yoke of his burden. Like Jesus said, "My burden is light." You know, so we carry his burden, not our own burden and not the burden of sin. We carry the burden of Christ. His burden is light. You know, the Lord is going to take care of us. And this is one of the great promises. And like, that's why you can read through the Old Testament and just go, hey, all these promises are for me. Because this speaks of Christ. And we know Christ. We're of Christ. But also, I just want you to meditate on the end of that verse 7 of Isaiah 9. It says, "The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." You know, the Lord came to save his people. And we know that to be the fulfilling of the law, living his perfect and sinless life, paying for our sins, all of that. And it's not just referring to Israel, but all those who are of faith. It's referring to all of us. You know, those who are before and after his coming. So they were looking forward to the coming Messiah, and we're looking back, you know. But it's all the same event. Everything, this whole world revolves around that one event of Christ coming. You know, even our calendar revolves around that. But the Bible says, "Whosoever will may take of the water of life freely." But the timing also of this was all generally known. Why? Because of prophets like Daniel, prophets like Jeremiah, you know, Isaiah, Ezekiel. They all prophesied of this stuff. In Daniel 9:26, it says, "After 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself, and the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined." So Daniel says the Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. And we know now in hindsight, that's him dying on the cross. He was cut off, but not for his own sins, but for the sins of the whole world. Because God was, you know, Jesus was sinless, he's God. And that was fulfillment of that scripture in Daniel. So they knew after 62 weeks, that's, you know, it's weeks of years, 62 times 7. But they did the math and they knew that this is about when the Messiah should come. So they're all waiting for him. And it was known. That's why people were waiting for him. There was people waiting in the temples and all of that. We saw that. The wise men were waiting for him. So I'll get you to turn to Luke chapter 1, verse 67. And there's a prophecy also for Zechariah. That's the father of John the Baptist. So he's the one who came before the Lord declaring him as the Messiah. You know, again, John fulfilled scripture. You know, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight." That's John the Baptist fulfilled that scripture. And in Luke 1:67. says, and his father Zacharias was filled with the Holy Ghost and prophesied, saying, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up an horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. Again, it's of the house of David again. We see that come up a lot, because that was a big prophecy, that he would be of the house of David, that there will forever be a king of Israel on the throne, which is Jesus Christ. He's the last king and the only king we need. In verse 70, and he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all they that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he sware to our father Abraham, that he would grant unto us that we, being delivered out of the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. And thou, child, shall be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, and was in the desert till the days of his showing unto Israel. So something we see fulfilled here too is about Jesus coming to preach righteousness, but not by the law. You know, so because Jesus, he was the Son of God, he fulfilled the whole law in himself. And that's how we also fulfill the law, because when we're, you know, when we believe on Christ, we receive, you know, Christ indwells us and we receive his righteousness. We receive what he did, not what we do. Because righteousness doesn't come by the law. But he was also teaching the gospel of peace, that whosoever believeth on him shall receive remission of sins. Your sins are forgiven. Your sins will not be remitted to you. So if you want to turn to Matthew chapter 8, I'll just read from Mark 1:14. It says, now after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. You're there in Matthew 8:17. So we move on to the next one now. That it might be fulfilled. It says, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bear our sicknesses. Now, Pastor Kevin's preached a good sermon on this, so I recommend listening to that one as well. But that's fulfillment of Isaiah, that, you know, that forbidden passage in Judaism of, you know, Isaiah chapter 53, which is actually one of our favorite chapters, is one they refuse to read because it testifies of Christ. And of course, they reject Christ. So Isaiah 53 exposes the lies of Judaism. But if you want to turn to Isaiah 53 verse 1, after that we'll be in Matthew chapter 12. But Isaiah 53 verse 1, it says, who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form of nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. So this is speaking, it's not just about his death on the cross and all the events leading up to that. But he also took on the infirmities of those whom he healed and raised from the dead and all the miracles that he did. He took on, you know, he healed many of the sick and the lame and the blind and you know, all of that. But again, those who understood scripture, they would have known what to look for. They would have been looking for the Messiah. They would have known who he was. They would have seen the miracles. And Jesus even says, believe me for the miracle's sake. If not for any reason, just because you see the miracles, believe that I'm of God. But they couldn't even do that. They just rejected him outright. And they were stubborn, but also unlearned. They were ignorant, you know, of what God is and what his promises were. And that was a good point from Sam this morning as well about how the children should not be ignorant. Certainly don't be ignorant of the scriptures. That's the last place you should be ignorant. You can be ignorant to the things of this world, but don't be ignorant to the scriptures. Because you'll fall into the same traps that these people did. Or you'll fall into the snare of the, you know, of the whorish woman. So in Matthew 12:15 it says, "But when Jesus knew it, he withdrew himself from thence, and great multitudes followed him and healed them all, and charged them that they should not make him known, that he might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, Behold my servant, whom I have chosen, my beloved, in whom my soul is well pleased. I will put my spirit upon him, and he shall show judgment to the Gentiles. He shall not strive nor cry, neither shall any man hear his voice in the streets. A bruised reed shall he not break, and smoking flax shall he not quench, till he send forth judgment and victory. And in his name shall the Gentiles trust." And that verse 21 is just a beautiful statement. In his name shall the Gentiles trust. See that, but that's fulfillment of Isaiah 42, which we'll read in just a second. But even there it speaks of bringing healing and judgment to the Gentiles. See, it wasn't just the covenant with Israel. Jesus came for a new and better testament that was to the Gentiles, to the Jews, to the Greeks, to whosoever will. And that was a mystery that was revealed later. We'll get to that in a second. But in Isaiah 42, the fulfillment, this is Matthew 12 is fulfilling Isaiah 42. It says, "Behold my servant whom I uphold, mine elect, in whom my soul delighteth. I have put my spirit upon him. He shall bring forth judgment to the Gentiles. He shall not cry nor lift up, nor cause his voice to be heard on the street. A bruised reed shall he not break, and the smoking flax shall he not quench. He shall bring forth judgment and truth." And this is why I love comparing scripture with scripture, because you get different things from different passages. You see that this is fulfilling that, but then you go back and read the original, and you're like, there's so much more there you can uncover. So that's why I highly recommend is when you see things like that it may be fulfilled, you go back and look, just do a search and look for where that might be. And then go read that too. And you'll get a better context of what they're speaking about. Verse 42, verse 4. "He shall not fail nor be discouraged till he has set judgment in the earth, and the isles shall wait for his law." If you want to turn to John chapter 16, verse 7, see, we see the Holy Ghost, the Comforter, actually fulfills that scripture as well in Isaiah 42. We'll be back at Isaiah 42. But I just want to show you this from John 16, 7. It says, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it's expedient for you that I go away. For I go not away, if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin, and of righteousness, and of judgment. Of sin, because they believe not on me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father, and ye see me no more. And of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged." So again, we see that Jesus said he's going to bring the judgment to the Gentiles. And judgment and truth. And so the Holy Ghost is the one that reproves the world, and shows that judgment and truth. As well as the Word of God also does that when we preach it, if you preach it right. So back in Isaiah 42, verse 5, it says, "Thus saith God the Lord, he that created the heavens and stretched them out, he that spreadeth forth the earth and that which cometh out of it, he that giveth breath unto the people upon it and spirit to them that walk therein, I the Lord have called thee in righteousness and will hold thine hand and will keep thee and give thee for a covenant of thy people, for a light of the Gentiles, to open the blind eyes, to bring out the prisoners from the prison, and them that sit in darkness out of the prison house. I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images. Behold, the former things are come to pass, and new things do I declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them." Again, Jesus is saying, just right away, he's just saying, look, I'm declaring new things. These things are going to come to pass. I'm just telling you before they're going to happen so that you know. It's like all throughout the Bible, you'll see that God tells us things well ahead of time because he wants us to know. But it's another foretelling here of God coming himself to save his people, to bring the righteousness of the law through himself, keeping that law and preaching righteousness through faith in him, bringing that light to the Gentiles. And we see that light again. That's the light through the gospel, preaching the kingdom of God. That's how we light up this wicked and dark world. is through the light of the gospel. That's how Jesus did it. So he started his ministry bringing the light by preaching the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. But there's also other promises as well. See, we can trust in every promise of God. That's why, you know, it was great that we had standing on the promises just before the sermon, singing that hymn, because we stand on those promises of God. There's promises of a new heaven and a new earth, a new body, you know, a new name given to us by the Father. So I'll get you to turn to Matthew chapter 13. And we'll see this next mentioned of prophecy being fulfilled. So Matthew 13:35, it says, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I'll open my mouth in parables, I'll utter things which have been kept secret from the foundation of the world. Now, I have a feeling this might be in Psalm 78, but I'm not entirely sure on that. I'm not even sure if this is contained in the books, but if it is, I have a feeling it might be Psalm 78. But it just explains that Jesus came to explain new things that were not revealed to the prophets before. You know, so there were some mysteries that were not revealed, like the Gentiles being fellow heirs with Israel. That was something that was revealed in the new covenant. That's why it's a better covenant, a better testament. You know, it's a holy nation made up of all believers. I mean, it always was, because even Abraham was looking forward, to a new kingdom, one made by God, not one made by men. But in Ephesians 3, verse 1, it says, for this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, whereby when you read you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. Wherefore I was made a minister according to the gift of grace of God, even unto me by the effectual working of his power. So this is something, a mystery that was revealed to the Apostle Paul as well as to Peter in the book of Acts. You know, where we had the animals come down on the sheep. God said, kill and eat. You know, and said, don't call that which I have cleansed unclean. You know, he's talking about the Gentiles, because there was still a separation between the Jews and the Gentiles at that point. So this is something that was taught, you know, throughout the book of Acts and all of that, that the kingdom is for everyone, whosoever believeth. If they're in Christ, then they're fellow heirs with Israel. So it's not about ethnicity. It's about what you believe. So, and we saw afterwards, Peter went and preached to the Gentiles in their house. I think they were Italians, you know, and he saw the Holy Spirit descend on them. They started speaking, you know, in his language, in Hebrew. He understood, you know, and they understood each other. So the next mention's in Matthew chapter 21, verse 1, if you want to turn there. In Matthew 21:1, it says, and when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem, and were come to Bethphage unto the Mount of Olives, and sent Jesus two disciples, saying unto them, go into the village over against you, and straightway ye shall find an ass tied and a colt with her. Loose them, and bring them unto me. And if a man say aught unto you, ye shall say, the Lord hath need of them. And straightway he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell ye the daughter of Zion, behold, the king cometh unto thee, meek, and sitting upon an ass, and the colt the foal of an ass. Of course, this is about the Lord's triumphal entry into Jerusalem, which was prophesied in Zechariah 9:9. It says, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, thy king cometh unto thee. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding upon an ass, and upon the colt the foal of an ass. So again, if you witness this, and you remember Zechariah, how can you know that's not you know that's the Christ. He said, the king's going to come, and this is how he's going to come. You know, and if you're standing in Jerusalem, that's why Jesus said, look, even if these people wouldn't shout out, the rocks themselves would actually shout out, you know, Hosanna, Hosanna, glory to God in the highest. Because it was going to happen anyway. God will fulfill it with or without you. You know, but that's the thing. This was proving the deity of Christ. It was proving the kingship of Christ. It was proving, you know, that he is the Son of God and the Messiah who came. And those who knew the scriptures, they would have looked for these signs. they would have been looking for them. When they saw them, they're like, oh, well, this is just fulfilling Zechariah. This is just fulfilling Isaiah, Ezekiel, you know. We knew this was going to happen, and he's fulfilling it all, or this must be the guy. You know, that's where your heart should be, not rejecting him because he's not what you thought he was. But you can see that danger of being ignorant to prophecy and being ignorant to God's word, not reading for yourself, not taking care and taking heed to the word of God. Because they built up a God, a Messiah in their own mind, someone who was going to come and rule on this earth, take control of the cities on this earth and hand it over to them. You know, and this was going to be the kingdom of Israel again on the earth, the ruled by God. But that's not what he came to do. He came to die on the cross. Now, he is coming to do that. There is a millennial reign that he's going to do that for 1,000 years. Jesus is the king of the earth, ruling and reigning with all of us. But they thought that he was going to do that the first time. But you can see, that's not what he came to do. And it was all prophesied that he came to do something different. He came to die for the sins of the world. Then he's going to come back and do that. But just imagine that you hate, you know, you just hate and reject the Messiah of God, condemning yourself just because you built up something in your mind and he didn't meet that. Like, that's why you should be careful too about what you think about God and what you say about God. Is he should match what the Bible says about God and what the Bible, you know, teaches, because God tells us who he is. So we shouldn't have some vain imagination of who God is. We should just believe the God of the Bible when it says this is who God is. God is a God of judgment. He's a God of fire and damnation. He's a God of righteousness. He's a God of peace. Like, we know all these things about God. He tells us who he is. And we shouldn't be ignorant to that. But you'll encounter it all the time as well when you go out preaching the gospel. People have built up God in their own mind and they reject him out of hand because, well, the one we're bringing doesn't match theirs. It's like, well, we've got the one true God. I don't know what you believe in. But, you just condemn yourself to hell because you won't believe in the one true God. We brought the report and you didn't believe it. You wouldn't receive our witness. So we're going to Matthew chapter 27, 35 now. Actually, you turn to Psalm 22, verse 7. I'll just read from Matthew 27. But there are just way too many scriptures that mention the death of Christ and everything that surrounds that. We wouldn't be able to go through all of them today. So I'm just going to go through a couple today. And then we'll conclude with an application after that. So Matthew 27:35, it says, "And they crucified him and parted his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, they parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture did they cast lots." So in Psalm 22:7, it speaks of this. It says, "All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip, they shake their heads, saying, he trusted on the Lord and that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. But thou art he that took me out of the womb. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breast. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my God from my mother's belly. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. Many bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me around. They gaped upon me with their mouths as a ravening and a roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws, and thou hast brought me into the dust of death. For dogs have compassed me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I may tell all my bones, they look and stare upon me. They part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture." So again, you see how much more detail you get when you go into the Psalms, you know, about some of the suffering that Christ went through. Because, you know, Matthew 27 is a fulfillment of that, his crucifixion. But there are a few things to take away from this. Firstly, David's called a prophet. So if you ever wondered, is David a prophet? Yes, David's a prophet, you know. Which is why, you know, that's the thing. A lot of his writings were actually very prophetic of Christ. Other than Moses, like, there, David spoke a lot of Christ. There's a lot, you know, you can read into of Christ's character and the things he would go through when he was to come, you know, just through the Psalms of David. But also it speaks how the Lord would be pierced in the hands and feet, and they would cast lots upon his clothing. And again, we see that fulfilled in the accounts of the Gospels. So So I'm sure there's many who witnessed that, him being crucified and him, you know, them casting lots and things like that, and thinking back to the Psalms and thinking, hey, you know, that sounds familiar. I think I've read that before. You know, it's how we should be. When we hear the word of God, we should go, hey, that reminds me of another verse. You know, and I know when we have conversations with the guys, that happens all the time. It's, you know, it's like, hey, that reminds me of this. You know, why don't we look up that and have a discussion about it, about the word of God. But so now I'm just going to wrap things up and give application, because it's so important that we just understand the promises of God, and also to know that we can trust in those promises. See, Jesus is the Son of God. He's the Word of God. He's the author and finisher of our faith. So he should be the beginning and end of everything you believe. And he's made promises. He's fulfilled everything he said he'd do. And he's left other promises. He said, hey, I'll fulfill those. Don't you worry about it. You know, that they're as good as done, but just wait. You know, you see that Abraham believed God, that he was able to do what he promised. And he knew that if he was to sacrifice his son, he knew that he would be raised up again. He believed that God would raise him from the dead, because he said, hey, out of your loins is going to come this, you know, innumerable number of people. That's all of us believers, by the way. You know, that promise wasn't just to the physical nation. It's to all who are of faith, the children of Abraham. So, but he knew that if he sacrificed his son on that altar, that God would raise him up. You know, just a picture that Jesus Christ would also be resurrected. But that's the thing, we partake of those same promises, and we can trust that what the Lord has done and what he said he will do, he will fulfill. So like in 1 Corinthians 15, he promises a new body, new heaven, new earth, one without sin, one without pain, one without suffering, to completely overcome death and hell, because Jesus overcame death and hell for us. But also that the Father's name is written in our foreheads, and a white stone is given with a new name by the Lord. You read all this in Revelation. I'll read to you from Hebrews 12:1. It says, wherefore, seeing we are also compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down on the right hand of the throne of God. In John 16:13 says, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he'll show you things to come. So if you've got the Holy Spirit of God, you're saved, you've got that Spirit of God, so he's going to show you things to come. So he wants to show you the things God's promised and say, hey, these things are for you. These things are going to happen. So just rest, you know, the burden is light, the yoke is easy. Just rest in the Lord, you know, that's why it's called his rest. Because we can trust that, hey, he's promised us a new heaven and new earth. We don't have to worry about this one, it's all going to burn up. You know, so whatever happens here, it's all temporal. Unless you build up rewards in heaven, and then you've got something for eternity. But the Holy Spirit guides you to the promises of God in Scripture. So to those future events and promises that we should expect. You know, and that's things like wisdom, knowledge, understanding, food and raiment, you know, eternal life, the day of the Lord. In Matthew 24, which is about the day of the Lord, you know, these end times, we're told to read and understand so that we know the danger and we know the signs of the times. In Matthew 24:15, it just says, when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place, whoso readeth, let him understand. And then down to verse 21, it says, for then shall be great tribulation, as such was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be, and except those days shall be shortened, there shall no flesh be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. So God just doesn't leave us without hope. He says, look, bad times are coming, but I'm going to pull you out of that. You know, I'm still going to, don't worry, I'm still watching what's happening, and I'm going to take care of my people. You know, so we know that he's always going to take care of us. If we're walking in his ways and doing what's right, he will take care of us. And, you know, that's the thing. That's all going to be fulfilled in one generation. And there's going to be saints who are persecuted like never before. I mean, I believe that it's going to be our generation, but, you know, the other people believe different things, and who knows? It could be at any time. It could be 100 years from now, 200 years. You know, it could be within 50 years. We just don't know. But the thing is, we're not to be offended because we're ignorant. You know, we're to know what the Bible says. And it even says, look, watch for these signs. When you see this sign, you know it's at hand. Before then, you don't know. So don't worry about it. But when you see these signs, you know, maybe start preparing because the Lord's coming. You know, you can even count down the days at that time. But we're not to be ignorant. In fact, at the end of Mark, it tells us to watch. You know, what I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. You know, and even we're also told not to fear. Because we know the Lord is strong. We know the Lord is just. I'll just read you from Proverbs 30, verse 5. It says, every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. Add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. So we have every word of God, and there's nothing missing from this. He's preserved it in total. So anything that's in here, we need to know. Anything that's not in here, we don't need to know. It's not important. And I like what a good IFB pastor has to say about extra-biblical revelation. He says, if the new revelation agrees with the King James Bible, it's redundant because we already have it in God's word. And if it does not agree with Scripture, then it's just a lie. It's just false. We don't need to know that either. So that's the thing. This book plainly tells us what we need to know. And the Spirit will search out the things we need to know. But we don't need these new things coming up that teach things that are not in the Bible, you know. Especially the books that were deliberately left out of the Bible, Gospel of Thomas, Book of Enoch, like all that garbage that they want to try and bring into the Bible. Those things are just fake. They don't line up with the rest of Scripture. You know, so God's told us what he wants us to know, but what he's left us, he expects us to know. And that's the expectation that comes down to you, is you need to know what that expectation is, that God expects you to know what his word says. So read it, you know, meditate on it, search it for wisdom. But yeah, you know, Jesus is the one who speaks to us. He speaks to us through his son. It says in those last days, he spoke to us through his son. And he's given us the apostles and prophets. And Peter even describes that as a more sure word of prophecy. Even after everything Peter saw, he still says, look, Scripture's a more sure word. Even the Old Testament is a more sure word than what he saw with his own eyes. So to get you to turn to 1 John chapter 5, this will be 1 John, I think, will be the last place I have you turn. We're almost done. But we're just going to look at what some of those promises are. So, you know, when you do your daily reading, you'll find so many more promises. So that's why I highly recommend you do your daily reading. Find all those promises and claim them for yourself, because God will do what he said he would do. And the Lord delights when you're praying to ask according to the Scriptures, like to ask, find his promises and say, Lord, this promise, you know, I want that. Give that to me. You promise, you give it to me. I'm asking you now, give it to me. Like, the Lord delights when you ask according to his word, according to his will. But of course, 1 John 5, the first promise is for our salvation and eternal life. Again, we have about the witnesses, but just in verse 10, he that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. And this is the record, that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. So again, I know most of you here have already believed that record, but if you haven't, that's the record you need to believe. 1 John 5 is the record you need to believe to receive eternal life. And you need to understand that God has given you eternal life, that life is in his Son, but also that no man can pluck you out of his hand. So in John 10:28, he says, and I give unto them eternal life, they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Now, if someone believes that they can lose their salvation, they're not saved. They don't have eternal life. Because you either have it or you don't. You know, no man can pluck you out of your Father's hand, not even yourself. And I believe that when it says I and my Father are one, it's talking about that Jesus and the Father are in agreement that no man can pluck them out of his hand. And that will both keep you. You know, it's the Lord that keeps us saved, not ourselves. We couldn't save ourselves if our life depended on it. You know, our eternal life does depend on it, and we couldn't do it. So we believe on Christ. He does it. He did it for us. You know, and eternal life. You can't lose eternal life because the name lends itself. If it's eternal, it's forever. And everlasting means it never ends. And Jesus uses both. He says, you'll never die. You know, you can't, there's no way around it. If you believe you can lose your salvation, you haven't believed the record. There's also another one in verse 14 of 1 John 5, another promise. It says, and this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we are petitions and that we desired of him. Again, that comes down to coming into the throne room of God. We can boldly enter that throne of grace and speak to the Father and put our petitions to him. And he says, hey, I hear you. I hear your petitions, and yeah, I'm going to grant them. You know, who else? Like, this is the God of the universe who created all things, that we can do that. We can go and boldly enter in as his son and say, Father, I need this. You know, and he hears us. And if it's according to his will, he'll give it to us. You know, so we don't ask things that are to bring lust upon our own selves. You know, you ask not, you have not because you ask amiss. You know, you're asking for the wrong things. You're asking for money or whatever. It's like, just look, seek the things of God and he'll give them to you freely. And there's another promise as well in John chapter 4. Sorry, no, Hebrews 13:5. The Lord will never leave us or nor forsake us. So as such, we don't need to fear man. You know, we can fear God, but we don't need to fear man. Hebrews 13:5 says, let your conversation be without covetousness and be content with such things as you have. For he said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. So that's why, you know, the reason he said that statement, that I'll never leave you nor forsake you, is so that we can be bold and say that the Lord helps me and I'm not going to fear man. I don't care what he thinks he can do to me, because the Lord's got me in his hand. There's nothing they can do about that. That's a great promise. The John 14:25, of course, we read about that Holy Spirit of promise, which is another fulfillment of never leaving or forsaking us, because we're indwelt by the Holy Ghost. God is actually with us. You know, the Holy Ghost says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Like, God dwells in us. Said, the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring you to remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. So again, another reason we don't fear, the Holy Ghost is with us. God's always with us. And nothing gets by him. You know, when someone's doing us wrong, God sees that. You know, when you're doing wrong, God sees that. So that's a two-edged sword as well. But, you know, we're commanded not to fear man. Because the Lord's with us, we don't fear. There's also the promise that the Lord forgives our sins when we repent. In 1 John 1:8, it says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. I'll read to you from Micah chapter 7, verse 18. It says, who is a God like unto thee that pardoneth iniquity and passeth by the transgression of the remnant of his heritage? He retaineth not his anger forever. Isn't that a great promise? God doesn't always, you know, God can forget. When you repent of your sins to God and you go to him for forgiveness, now not for salvation, of course, but after you're saved, we sin every day. We have to go and repent to God. It says, look, he doesn't hold his anger forever. So if he's forgiven you of that, and he does, he says he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, that we can move on. We can repent. We can, you know, forsake our sins and we can move on. Now that's a great promise too. It says, because he delighteth in mercy, he will turn again, he will have compassion upon us, he will subdue our iniquities, and that will cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. In the Psalms it says, hides our sins behind his back, as far as the east is from the west, that's how far he separated our sins from us. And you can apply this to both salvation and as well, you know, to repenting of your sins after salvation, because God is forgiving in both instances. He's, you know, his sins and iniquities will I remember no more, he says. That's in regards to salvation, you know. But we still need to repent when we sin to keep a clear account with God. But it says, thou wilt perform the truth to Jacob and the mercy to Abraham, which thou hast sworn unto our fathers from the days of old. So again, God promised very early on to Abraham, to Moses, to all these people that he would be a God of mercy. And we've seen throughout Scripture that he is a God of mercy. And we've got the promise of the resurrection, as I brought up 1 Corinthians 15 before. You know, so in the likeness of Christ's resurrection, we're going to receive a glorified body without pain, sickness, or death. So the corruptible will put on incorruption. And that's how the Apostle Paul would have understood. By reading David and the Psalms and all of that, that speaks of these same things. You know, that this is how the apostles, not just through revelation, but also from the Scriptures, they would have known these things. And 1 Corinthians 15 is probably the greatest on the promise of this new heaven, new earth, new body. So I'll just read. Yeah, but thanks be to God, which give us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. So again, that's a promise of rewards. What we do on this earth will be rewarded for in heaven. So I've just got a little bit now. Mark 6, verse 11. So the last one we're going to go at, the last promise is that the wicked are going to be judged. In Mark 6, 11, it says, whosoever shall not receive you nor hear you when you depart thence, shake off the dust of your feet for a testimony against them. Verily I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. John 5, 27, and hath given him authority to execute judgment also because he is the Son of Man. And of course, Revelation 20, verse 11, you've got the great white throne judgment. It says, I saw a great white throne, him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their works. Now, this is not our judgment. We don't stand before the great white throne. We stand before the judgment seat of Christ. It's a different judgment. This is for those who haven't believed. And that's why it says, whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Because they're judged according to their works. So we can understand the unrighteous. They will be judged. So when you see the most wicked people abounding in this world, you know, just don't envy them, because you know what their end's going to be. You know, they might be succeeding now, but they're not going to succeed forever. Because one day they will have to stand before the Lord, not even stand, but kneel before the Lord, bowing down. Because every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. These people who hate God now, they will be worshipping him one day, but they'll still be cast into hell because they didn't believe on him while they were alive. And they'll all be judged on their works. So we don't envy them because we know what the end is. And we can have peace about that. And that's the thing, you don't need to fight them because the Lord will judge them. You know that their judgment's coming. They might not be judged in this life, but they will be judged in the next. You know, so we fight spiritual battles against the workers of iniquity, but we win by preaching the word of God without compromise. We don't win by taking on their fight. We win by preaching the word. And that goes not just for confrontation or soul winning, but also behind the pulpit. You should also be preaching in the church house, uncompromising the word of God. Because we've committed to God our life, our body, our resurrection, our eternal salvation. He's promised us a new body and eternal life. We know he's good for it, but that's the thing. We should be settled on that as well. So I recommend reading through 1 Corinthians 15. I know pastor's already gone through that as well. There's a good sermon on that if you want to listen to that. And read through Revelation as well as Daniel, just to understand the signs of the times and the things that are warned, you know, that they're warning us against. Because I believe that some of this may happen in our lifetime. It may not, but we should still be prepared regardless. You know, we should not be ignorant to any of the word of God. But even to read through the epistles of Paul and the promises of the saints, the Psalms, you know, of course the Proverbs are really good too. Just to read through and understand the Lord is our strength, he's our protection, the Lord is our shield, you know, he's our buckler of strength. Like, that's where you'll read that through the Psalms and through the Proverbs, just how the Lord does love us and take care of us, all the promises he's given to us. He'll never leave us nor forsake us. And our comfort is in knowing these things, knowing we're the Lord's, and that the promises yet to be fulfilled will be fulfilled. There's no question. Everything that he's promised in the word will be fulfilled. You know, and that includes raising us up on that last day with the saints unto glory and everlasting life. So I'll just finish on this verse. 2 Timothy 1 verse 12 says, "For the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day."